Hello, I'm Lisa Burkhart-Worley, and welcome to Pop Talk, the show where you never know what topics might pop up. Do you want to be closer to Jesus? Do you want to go from an intellectual understanding of Christ to a heart relationship with Jesus Christ? Well, we've got a woman here today who's going to tell you all about how to do that, and she's written a book that will help you as well. So you want to stick around because you don't want to miss this show. But before I introduce her, I want to introduce our Pop Talk co-host. It's Rosemary LeGrand.
Hello, everyone.
It's good to see you, Rosemary.
Yes.
And you look
so
beautiful
good to be
as
here.
Usual.
Thank you.
Well, let me introduce our guest for today. Her name is Deidre Riley. Deidre's worked as a senior writer and editor in digital media. She's hosted a major market radio show. She's written a nationally syndicated newspaper column, and her work has been carried by the Boston Herald, the Dallas Morning News, Fox News, and other publications. Pretty amazing. Well, today she contributes to websites including CBN.com, RealClearReligion.org, and she's a regular contributor for Crosswalk.com. I'm sure you've heard of that as well. Yeah. Deidre is also the author of the new book. Let me show it to you. The Pretend Christian, Traveling Beyond Denomination to the True Jesus. And it debuted at number 2 on Amazon's Hot New Releases in Christian Faith. So I'm just so excited to have you on the show, Deidre. We've talked on the phone, but we've never have met in person, but it was an immediate chemistry. You know, it's just so good
we
to have you here.
We had a soul sister
yes,
oh, thing going on sisters. Here.
And so we want to do the show so we can go to dinner afterwards.
Hey, that's what I'm here for. That's it.
Well, I just love this book. I went all the way through it, and it's just a great topic. The topic is what actually drew me, but then as I got into it, I understood why I needed to read it. And the first chapter really actually was amazing and drew me in. It was called, Can Religion Cause Rashes? Okay. Now, I've had rashes because I'm very fair complected and I, you know, get the touch stuff that I'm allergic to and I get a rash. But sometimes stress can cause rashes. So how can religion cause rashes or stress?
Well, it's so nice to be here. Thank you so much. And I'm a fan of the show.
Good.
So
thank you.
It's a treat for me. But, you know, my publisher actually said, are we going to start this book with a title like Rashes? Can Religion Cause Rashes? But really, what I was expressing there, I've been through all stages of non-belief to belief. And I think God has really blessed me by letting me empathize with each stage, even now as a committed believer. And so I start the book with this topic, Can Religion Cause Rashes? I was really talking as my former non-believing self. And when I would be in church, there's a certain, some people call it Christianese, where, you know, I would hear phrases, oh, blood of the Lamb, oh, we fellowship together. As a non-believer, it sounded like a secret, exclusive language. Mm-hmm. And I was just kind of, oh, you know, what are they talking about? Why can't they talk in ways that I can understand? So I think religion, though, to answer your question, Lisa, can cause stress. I think for the non-believer is really afraid, if I became a Christian, I would have to change. Mm. It would cost me. And that can be very frightening. And they're also afraid of, maybe you have high profile Christians who fall very publicly. And they say, well, I can't believe in that faith. Look what they just did. It's all hooey. And so there are a lot of roadblocks and there's a lot of stress around faith for non-believers. Mm. And for believers, I think the stress is keeping the feeling alive.
Right.
Keeping the spirit alive. And also Christianity is increasingly under attack. Mm. So as Christians, we want to know how to love, how to present Jesus' love, yet also be faith defenders.
I think sometimes we forget, don't we, what it was like when we didn't know Jesus.
Exactly.
We start falling into all that Christianese. Are you saved? You know, it's like, you know, I have a friend who said, saved from what?
Yes.
You know,
yes.
So we don't understand, you know, people don't understand that.
They don't. And, you know, for some reason, I'm very empathetic. And I wrote the book, really, if you know someone who, you know someone who needs God, who needs Christ's saving love, but they shut you down. They don't want to hear about it, and they get rashes when you talk about it. Give them this book. Put it by their bedside and don't say a word.
So Rosemary, when we're talking to somebody about Jesus and they get a rash, I think we better go like, zip that.
It's a rash-free book. It's a rash-free book.
Do you know, Deirdre, there are a lot of people that start going to church, but sometimes, you know, when things bother them, they just stop going to church. And there are other people that just don't know, they don't even know how to start a relationship with Jesus Christ. What would you tell me or tell our audience that really keeps people from Christianity?
That's such an important question. And we know church attendance is declining. Why? You know, why is that? And I really just feel like when we go to church, there's been a growth in a thought, how do I feel at church? It's all about me. It's all about my experience at church. So we church hop over and over again, trying to find the experience that best suits us. Well, that is important because you need to be fed by the word. But really, church is about giving back to God, worshiping God. It's really about you and God, not just you. And sometimes when we get turned off by a church, unless there's good reason, and sometimes there is, sometimes they're straying from the word. Sometimes, you know, churches are getting very social justice oriented. And frankly, I think we can hear that all day long at work, in our neighborhoods, in our families. Church is for worship.
True.
It's that relationship.
That's right.
So if you've lost the personal and don't want to attend church, you're not alone. There are reasons, and they're valid, for why you feel the way you do. But I would say, remember, don't leave one very important person out, and that's God. Person and deity.
Yes.
It's you and God talking together. It's not solely you that you have to worry about.
I had a friend at my old church who was upset with the preaching or something like that. Anyway, and so someone came to her and said, maybe you're not here for you. Maybe you're here for someone else. And so that same Sunday, she ended up next to somebody who had lost their husband and held her hand all the way through the church. So sometimes we're there for worship. That's the primary thing. But maybe we're there to give a kind word to someone else or to meet someone and encourage them. I don't know. There's other reasons why we're at church. You know, and then people segment their lives, don't they? They go to church on Sunday, and then during the week they work, and then Friday and Saturday is fun time, party time, then it's back to church again, rather than living a life of faith every day, you know, 24/7, taking Jesus with you to work, taking Jesus with you when you socialize, that kind of thing, not just church. And you learned that in your own life, didn't you? Can you talk about that?
And it's a topic I just love because, you know, I talk about in the book trapping God in church. And, you know, so you have this hour or two on Sundays. If you're lucky, maybe you give them all day, although none of us really, you know, seem to have the time. I try to take Sundays off. But I think bringing God, the maker of heaven and earth, into every moment that we can of every day. And I believe, since I love to talk about the personal relationship, that begins with being really real. And a lot of times our prayers might just be a sigh, Lord, help me. It might be a tear. I don't have words. I'm so sad, God, but I invite you in. And I think if we even try to be perfect before God and we leave our human self to deal with the world, that's wrong. God wants to be with us in every moment. And I talk in the book too about God loves our adventurous side, our fun side. I learned that teaching my children. I was their Bible teacher, and they were saying, we are tired of learning about God and Jesus, blah, 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 as kids do. And I said, hold on a minute. And God gave me the words. I said, we're talking about the God that loves when you snowboard, yes, that loves when you laugh with your friends, that loves every good endeavor you try, every decent thing you do. God is there. So to bring God into our everyday, we just have to keep it real. God, I'm at the market, a little bit frustrated right now. Be here with me. Yes. Keep my eyes open for ways I can help others and for ways you're talking to me.
You know, sometimes I know that, and I'm sure Rosemary's done this too, but when you pray that the Lord will bring somebody in front of you who needs to hear about, you know, he needs to be encouraged, yes, or he needs to hear about him, he will do it. And I'm just guilty of not praying that every day. But when I do, he places somebody in front of me, and it's during the week, right?
That's,
it's not just
it's
on
not
Sunday.
It's not on Sunday. He's not going to only send hurting people to church.
Yes.
Hurting you, all you need to do today. We live in fractious times, and there's a lot of loneliness, a lot of heartache, and a lot of, I think, quiet despair. Mm. In the world. And so God, we need the personal so we can bring God to others. We need to have that fire given by God so that we can extend it.
Exactly.
And that's a very, God wants us to get real. God wants us to get personal.
He really does, because he said we are the light of the world. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so a lot of people are looking to us, especially once we deem ourselves as being Christians. You know, and we talked about that early on. I told you that I felt a little discombobulated, and then I had to go to him and I had to say, okay, Daddy, what's going on right now?
And I think you ended up dancing.
You know, I did. You know, and I just went on to do some praise and worship, and then I was right back to where I was supposed to be. You know, and sometimes, you know, we can have some type of emotional mountaintops. Now, my mountaintop for me is always to be in worship. You know, I get so, I mean, I sense the presence of God, not negating the word or negating any type of devotional, because I do that too, and that's very important. But my question to you is, how do we trust our emotions when it comes to our faith journey?
Such a great question, Rosemary, and I think you're going to become a soul mentor to me. Both of you are wonderful, but I talk about emotion in the book because I was distrustful of emotion as a non-believer. Mm. I went from non-believer to questioner to, okay, maybe there's something here, I'll investigate more, to a pretender, which is what I talk about, where I was doing everything right? Going to church, raising the kids, but I was extremely hollow inside to that moment, my Holy Spirit moment. But emotion, I didn't trust. I didn't trust it. I said, well, sure, they feel good in church. There's music. There's a fired up pastor. But what do they do when they leave? And what do they do when tragedy strikes? Mm. Then it all falls apart. So non-believers are worried about that part. You know, if I give to God now, if I give him my heart, I know bad things will happen. Why would a loving God do that? And I'd be a fool to trust that. Mm. No, you wouldn't. You wouldn't. You just need to take those tiny steps. My journey was 40 years. Mm. But I believe God honored every step. I was in a relationship because I wanted to know more, and I wanted to, and I brought my doubts. Mm-hmm. And there were more than a few times I said, this can't be real. I'm a smart person. But when God wants you, God wants you. Mm-hmm. And nothing's going to stop that.
And he's okay with doubts. He, mm-hmm. yeah, doubting Thomas. We mm-hmm. hear about Thomas
yes.
in the Bible.
Yes. Sure.
Yeah, and a lot
yes.
of them doubted.
Sure.
And he calmed their doubts, and he explained things to them. And even when they didn't get the parables, he would explain it. And even so, when we get into the Word of God, you know, if we don't understand something, we can ask for the Holy Spirit to tell us, what does this mean? I don't get this. And so I want to get to the meat of all this. You left off that you were a pretend Christian. You'd gotten to that point in your life where you're going through the motions. You're probably reading the Bible, teaching your kids Sunday school, whatever that was. By the way, that's how I started my journey after I rededicated my life to Christ. I call it starting in the school zone. I taught my kids Sunday school, and so I learned along with them. So I really had no background in the Bible, and so that was a great way to learn. And I tell you, if you have a chance to teach Sunday school and you want to know more about the Bible, that's a great way to do it. Mm-hmm. But so how did you get from being a pretend Christian to an on fire Christian who walked the talk?
Well, it was really an interesting journey. And a pretend Christian, and a lot of people say, oh, you're calling out people. No, I'm talking about myself mm-hmm. only. Only God judges others. And so I was, that feeling of not feeling anything is very lonely, because you see that you're doing all the right things. You're going to church, you're teaching your children, you're praying, but there's nothing coming back. It's a dial tone. Mm. It's just a dial tone. And that can be very frustrating. And of course you can't depend on that when hard times come. But what I did was, and I was informed by many different denominations, I am a famous church hopper. As long as it's Bible-based, I'm there. Invite me and I'll come. And so I took a little bit from each church. And I was in a program started by Church of England. And C.S. Lewis had opened my eyes. I love to read. And I love data and facts. But C.S. Lewis was layering in the theology, the deeper walk, and the great questions. And so I was reading C.S. Lewis. I'd been a believer for years, and I was in this program called Alpha with a neighbor. And concepts were breaking through, and Alpha takes you as a beginning, a baby Christian. And I thought I was such a developed Christian, because of course I've been speaking and talking and, you know, teaching. But I liked being back in the beginning. Foundations. Who is Jesus? When did he live? What did he say? And I found myself responding very positively in my heart. So I was with my friend, and I said to her, and it was so funny, I felt anxious this one night. We were in the car, and the windshield wipers were going. It was raining. And I looked at my friend, and I said, you know, things are breaking through to me. I just have to do more and be better. So, of course, that's wrong.
Right.
I just had to open up. And all of a sudden, Rosemary and Lisa, it was a metaphysical, people long for a spiritual experience, and I finally had mine. And it was just a dawning, and I realized it is all real. You could stake your life on Jesus' life, because he did it for you. And it was so overwhelming. I said goodbye to my friend, because I wanted to be alone with my new life, my new reality. And I ran inside and I grabbed a kid's Bible, and I was flipping the pages, and I was just crying. I understood every simple illustration. I understood every little word. And I just said, Jesus, there you are.
Oh, I love that.
Ooh, I found you, and you found me. Indeed.
That's your next book, Jesus, there you are.
I share it because I was someone who never thought I could have that. And believe me, you can have it. God will get you if he wants you.
Yeah.
Wow. And we talk a lot about the Holy Spirit, because he's really our comforter. The story that you just told, was that the supernatural experience you had during your stressful time?
Well, Rosemary, I was so hard-headed. I'd actually had experience before my experience in the car. I had had an experience as a young wife and mother. We were broke. My husband was traveling. The baby had been up all night. Mm. And my little one had just found his voice. And he talked to me 24 hours a day nonstop, to the point where I just wanted to So I was sitting and my husband's traveling and there were dirty diapers in the trash can. And I just thought, Lord, and of course I didn't have a relationship with God then, but out of desperation, and desperation can bring you to God, as many who've suffered know. I said, Lord, did I make mistakes everywhere? Should I have even married? Are we having these kids too fast? Help me. And I said, I don't even know if you're real, but just please help me to feel better about this. And I got up from the table and I went to our kitchen sink and the wind, and I've always been a nature gal, and God used nature to speak to me. The wind was just blowing trees over in my yard and just shaking my yard. And I stared at it like, can this be? And I just felt the words, I am here. Mm. And the reason I trust it is because it calmed me.
Yes.
I immediately calmed down.
Yes.
So even if after that, this is how strong doubt is, even after that supernatural experience, I went on to have years of of doubt.
Yeah, there's a passage, Psalm 56:3 that says, when I'm afraid, I put my trust in you. That's a great psalm to claim for our lives. You know, okay, I'm afraid and I want to doubt, but even though my mind says don't trust, I'm going to put my trust. It's almost an act of obedience to put our trust in God. And you talked about this a little bit. I know you know that I'd recently had COVID. And so during that time of being sick, and I knew people that had died, I just had to put my trust in God, whatever the outcome. You know, if he was going to save me from it, I was going to trust. If not, I'd be with him. It's like Paul said, it's better to be with the Lord than to be here. But so I just trusted through that whole thing. It's hard to do that when you go through trials. So what are some ways that we can trust? And how normal is it to not trust on a faith journey?
I think it's so normal. Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, Jesus understood humanity. He understood, like the apostles we were talking about, he loved them through their doubts. And he loves us through our doubts. In our times of, you know, when the rubber meets the road, and say COVID, and thank God for your healing, so grateful. And when the rubber meets the road, whatever it is, of course our faith is going to dim maybe a little bit. And I've asked myself, many Christians have, you know, if it came to it, would I claim Jesus in the moment before my death? That's me being human and hoping I'm good enough and hoping I can be a Christian to the end. And but I don't know. I don't know that answer, but I know every day I'm giving him my best. And God is justice. So he knows my heart and your heart. We don't ever have to worry if the correct thing will happen. If we try to stay in alignment, you can get no more just than God. And, you know, as social justice initiatives come, and many of them are worthy and good. But I guess I feel like if you could take that leap into the Lord, then you'll really experience justice. Mm. And so I just think the personal, it's okay to doubt, and you will have your wonderful moments of clarity.
Yeah, and there's that one story in the Bible where he says, help me with my unbelief, right?
Yes.
He wanted to believe, but he said, Lord, help me with my unbelief. And I think that's something that we can do when we feel that doubt coming on. You know, Lord, hey, I don't know why I'm doubting, but help me with that unbelief.
And I don't even try to hide it anymore. You know, back when I was a pretend Christian, I did. But it's in the way, and we are his children, in the way that it's always refreshing when a child fesses up and just says, I feel this way. I feel broken. I feel lost. Then you can help. Hmm. But if that child doesn't tell you, have to look for clues. So with God as the ultimate parent, I think he loves when we say, Lord, I messed up big time.
Indeed.
Or I've strayed pretty far from you.
Yes.
I don't know how to get back.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, another thing is sit with the word. I heard a pastor recently say, and I love this, there's a reason we're called human beings and not human doings. I love that.
It's awesome.
We are beings that are his.
Yes.
So spend time with him.
Amen. It is, you know, and the most important thing too is that he understands. You know, you can go to an understanding God. And having the correct image of God is so important. And sometimes we think that he's a rule maker, but he's much more than that. Mm. Yeah, so could you tell us about the attributes of God that you personally have discovered?
Oh, thank you. I've discovered God is immediate. I've discovered God is mercy, along with being justice. I've discovered God loves our funny, good, decent, loving endeavors. And he, you know, what I was doing, being a pretend Christian, I was never farther away than when I was doing all the right things.
Yeah.
And I'd rather be who I am now, who maybe I'm not perfect. Maybe I skip church every once in a while. But the thing is, I love him. He loves me. Mm-hmm. And to put some context to that, I think the word is the most important thing. But we can't get interested in learning the word until we try to develop the personal. Unless God wants us to, a prisoner may pick up the Bible and the Holy Spirit illuminates it for that prisoner.
Yeah.
But for us, just pray first and God will bring you to the Bible passages that mean something to you.
Well, I heard a great message today, and it was just what you're saying. They said, just think about who God is to you. Who is Jesus to you? And I started thinking about a lot of different descriptions. You know, he's a healer, he's a redeemer, he's a lover, he's a father. You know, I started thinking about all the things that God is to me. And sometimes it gives us a heart of gratitude that we might not have had before. We begin to be more grateful for our faith and for this relationship that has developed. So 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, you know, we're a new creation. You know, when we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, he does work on the inside that we can't do possibly on our own. So looking forward to this day, to, you know, you being on the show, writing the book, how has God worked in your life?
He's working all the time. He just was working. I was telling Rosemary, an Uber driver who brought me over here. I said to Rosemary, maybe we don't ever really know why we're compelled to do something. Maybe I was supposed to talk to this Uber driver who needed encouragement. So I think from here, we try to give. We try. As Christians, we are the light. You know, we're now we contain the light. So we do have a job to offer hope, to offer understanding. And a big part of the book is I think Christians need to become better listeners. Mm-hmm. If someone's struggling, instead of saying, well, God loves you, don't you know that? And here's a passage. Why don't we try to say more of, tell me about that?
Yeah. Yeah. You have to start a relationship. Sometimes it takes weeks and months and years to continue that relationship so you have that opportunity to tell them about the Lord, right? You just ask for that perfect opportunity. So, Deidre, thank you so much for being here on Pop Talk. We've just really enjoyed this. I know you've helped so many people. I love this book, The Pretend Christian. Everyone needs to go on Amazon and get this book. I think it'll be a great book for your library and also to just teach you about how to be an authentic Christian, authentic believer. And if you want to contact Deidre, I know she'd be available to speak or just maybe even do a Zoom meeting for your church whatever.
Anything.
Yeah, she's available. You can find her at DeidreReilly.com. It's DeidreReilly.com. And we would just love for you to reach out to us here at Pearls of Promise Ministries. You can find us at pearlsofpromiseministries.com. You can email us with your prayer requests, info@pearlsofpromiseministries.com. We're on social media, on Facebook, Twitter at Pop Talk Media, and Instagram at pop_ministries.
And thanks to all of our amazing television platforms. There are so many to watch. So many different areas to watch Pop Talk show. We are grateful for 9 of our platforms, Lisa. Would you believe that?
Oh, there's a lot, yes. Rosemary. And we want to thank Grace Point Media. For all of your media needs, go to gracepoint.media. So that is Pop Talk for today. We're just ordinary girls
who God's turning into pearls.
Have a wonderful week.